Hi, I'm Jesper Pedersen from KDAB. If you have a fetish for black colors and think that the most beautiful color in the world is 100% transparent black, you can stop watching now. Otherwise, please hang on. I'm going to tell you about colors in QML. And I'm going to tell you about gradients, so going from one color to another color, possibly over several steps. Whether gradients is the best thing ever or they are a terrible idea in user interfaces, I'm not to judge, but if your designer comes around and say, I would like a gradient looking exactly like this, then you know how to do that in QML. The colors can be specified in three different ways in QML. You can specify them using the SVG names, so red, green, blue, xeon, black, white, transparent. Or you can use it using a hash mark and then 6 to 8 digits. Hex digits, sorry. So hash mark alpha alpha RRGGBB. So 008000, that means no red, 80 green, and 00 blue. And down here we have 8, so FF means, well, that's the alpha channel. Or you can do it using, there's a global element in QML that's called Qt. And Qt.rgba, and here you specify the color like this. It's really not that complex. Now you just know that there is these different ways that you can do it. Here is the here's an example. I specified red here with doing like this. I specified green with the Qt.rgba, and I specified blue using the letters blue. Yeah, that's it. Gradients, on the other hand, you can specify that in two different ways. You can either specify it using the gradient element, and you create a gradient element that you put on the gradient property, as we see in this example here. Here I have a gradient that goes from green to blue. You see green pixels up here, blue pixels down there. And at position 0, 0, that's up here, we are entirely green. And position 1.0, that's 100% through, we're entirely blue. I could, of course, have it at a bit out so that I was already a bit into the green when I hit the edge there, and I could stop before and then it would just be blue all the way to the end. That's up to you. Let's just run this example here and see what it looks like. Start with green, end in blue. That's cool. So as I said, we could start at -0.5 and end at 0.9 if I wanted to. It looks like this. Well, not much gradient, but it starts with a green out here and ends around here, and then it's just plain blue from there on. That's a silly example. Let's go and look at the gradient stop here. Well, let's first try and add a color in between so we can see that's working too. At halfway through, we would like to be, I'm good with color, so let's choose yellow, green. Halfway through, we are entirely yellow, and at the end, we are entirely blue. Okay, let's go and look at the gradient element here. Reference documentation. And you can see there's color, and there is, oh, that was gradient stop. What did I do? Back, gradient, please. There we are. Stops, colon. What? Nothing else? No ankle, no nothing? Well, this is a reference documentation for 5.10 because I'm lazy. I don't have the very latest new Qt version on my computer. But if we went and looked at Qt 5.12, there's even an orientation so I could specify either horizontal or vertical. But how about if I want like just a gradient that goes like this? Sorry, not supported. Come on, we can do that. All you need to do is to rotate. So if I rotate here, my element by 90 degrees, let's just see what it looked like originally. We were going from green at the top to blue at the bottom. And now I rotated 90 degrees, rotation 90. Then you can see that I go from blue to green. So I rotated 90 degrees. I could also rotate it. That part was available in Qt 5.12, but how about 45 degrees? That's definitely not available. I can do that just with a rotation. But observe that my rectangle, when it's rotated 45 degrees, then I will see the outside. That's this rectangle, this triangle that I have there. That's the outside part that I see. So for that, I also need to scale my rectangle. So let's just scale it by 50%. And now you can see it looks good. That's one way of doing gradients. If you go to Stack Overflow or similar, you might end up on a page that says, gradient done with a gradient element, super expensive. You should be using images instead. And yes, I can just create an image, and let me just show you exactly what that would look like. That would look like this. Here I have two images that I create here. I hope that you're still with me and you didn't stop when I said gradients are super expensive to do, because that's not true anymore. It was true in the days of Qt Quick 1. That is in the days of Qt 4.8. Back then, it was expensive because the engine behind QML was Qt Graphics View, which was a raster-based engine. Today, QML is backed up in Qt Quick 2 versions, backed up by OpenGL. So doing a gradient is just GPU work, and the GPU is super good at that. There is, however, one reason why you might still want to do gradient using images. If you are on a 16-bit display, or even an 8-bit display, oh my God. If you're on one of those, then you will notice, or then you'll know that you have 2^8 different colors that you can have on your graphics card. 2^8, that is 512 or 256 or whatever. I'm not good at that math. Okay, you want it 2, 4, 8, 16, 32, 64, 128, 256 colors. Okay, good. So 256 colors in total is what you have on 8-bit displays. And that is not a lot of colors, because you also need to share your green variants with the red variants, with the blue variants, with the green-blue variants, and so on. So you will have very few different colors just for the green spectrum. There is a solution to that problem. The solution is called dithering. Your graphics artist will know everything about that, but it's the same kind of general thing that you do when you do anti-aliasing, where you just have a line here and you just do a bit of blobs outside that is in a slightly different color. So I'll put a note in the description underneath for an excellent article on dithering that you can see what's that about. Also, I have one for banding, where you can see the problem of having a gradient run on only 8-bit. With that said, if you have a fixed size display, you might be better off with gradients in images. Unless you happen to want that to happen to be on a retina display on an Apple product, because there the image is going to be so incredible big that your iOS will likely come around and say, gee, you are spending a lot of memory, I better go and kill you. In projects in KDAB, we learned that the hard way. We had our application crash ever so often simply because iOS came around and said, you are really burning a lot of memory. And so the solution was to avoid having a gigantic background image and solve that in different ways. So in that situation, but then again, the retina display definitely have more than 8 or 16 bits color depth, so it's not a big problem there. But just be warned with that. So the good old thing, Qt Quick 1, gradient elements is slow, do not apply anymore, but we do still, if you have 8 or 16 bits display, still have the problem of banding, and that can be solved with images. That was it for this group of videos. This module is at the end. We've seen images, we've seen transformations, we've seen layout, and we've seen now color and gradients, which have built up a toolbox for you to actually be able to create at least some set of application. And you, of course, have seen the text and the text input elements already in previous videos. So you can actually create somewhat usable applications now. You're missing out on one thing, though. You're missing out on how do you interact with your users beyond typing text in. How do you do with this little finger here that you want to swipe or you want to zoom or whatever? And that's what the next module is going to be about. We're going to talk about mouse input or finger for that matter, because they are really the same thing. We're going to talk about keyboard. We're going to talk about gestures. And when we talk about keyboard, by the way, we're going to talk about focus scope. I will bet you that there's going to be a lot of new viewers exactly on that video because that they will be fighting focus scope. But hey, if you just stay in there, I will teach you focus scope so you'll never forget how it works again. Thank you for this time. Looking forward to seeing you later on.